started, we were all stuck. I was because I'm on right now. I'm on sabbatical, and I was working on rural issues, rural transformation, agrarian transformation, and those kinds of issues. So when this whole COVID phenomenon, COVID shock came, I was thought of immediately started thinking as to what's going to happen to rural, because I was so much immersed in rural. So then immediately I started looking for literature, and then I happened to do some bit of literature review about China, to understand as to what has happened in China, particularly in the rural context. And that gave me some insights, and I was therefore able to visualize what possibly might happen in India based on Chinese experience. I wrote a small article which I shared with my colleagues and with other people. And then subsequently, I also started following as to what is happening, because every day a lot of data being shared globally and also within the country, and a lot of debates, discussion, and a lot of literature also. So as I was curious, I started pursuing this theme. I started sort of understanding as to what is happening in general, and more so in the rural area. So there were some very interesting kinds of reports coming from rural areas, some good, some bad, some ugly scenarios, right, happening all over. So then I thought that I should attempt somewhat systematically as to what is the scenario in rural areas, what has happened in terms of economic and social issues, and what is likely to be the scenario. And therefore, this seminar is the result of such a kind of reflection. Yeah. So my presentation will consist of at least five areas, broad areas, because wherein first I will give some introduction as to what I exactly want to do and how I want to proceed. And then I would specifically go into the issue of COVID in rural areas. That is my second section, where I make an attempt to capture the incidence of COVID in rural areas. So then in my third section, I will be touching upon the impact of COVID and of course the lockdown on rural livelihoods, and more so on the issue of migration. Of course, we have been seeing a lot of migrants pouring out on the roads, all those heart-wrenching scenes, right? In fact, has affected us in many ways. So I thought that since I was already pursuing some research on rural migration, I will try and capture possibly why this has happened, why these rural migrants are all out and want to go back home, and what does that mean for their livelihoods, and also possibly for impact of COVID. So therefore, I will be attempting that based on my research in two villages, right, as to what the insights from those two villages tell, and possibly project for the wider area. And also, of course, this is an unprecedented crisis. Globally, of course, all the countries have announced various relief measures and packages. Of course, Government of India has also been announcing, even today, Finance Minister was announcing a package for the farmers and the rural segment, even including migrants. So based again on my research findings, I will try and see what is the potential impact of these relief measures of the program, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, as they are calling it. And of course, at the end, in the last section, so I would conclude based on my findings, and then also draw some implications for rural and rural livelihoods. Yeah, so that is the scheme of my presentation. Yeah, so let me straight away start as to what I want to do, what are my objectives, right, and why I'm doing this. Yeah, of course, we all know COVID-19 is an unprecedented global pandemic. Probably after the 1918 influenza, this is one pandemic. There have been so many pandemics and epidemics, but this is one which has been of a global kind of a scale, right? Affected almost all the countries, and also the incidence, right? The population that has been hit by COVID has been very, very high. Of course, the influenza had hit even much higher level. But given currently the kind of interconnectedness that we have globally, interconnectedness in terms of travel, economic activities, etc. So the impact of COVID, particularly on the economic and social side would be much higher than the influenza, though influenza had even much higher incident. Yeah, it is estimated that more than 500 million had been affected by the influenza of 1919. Yeah, of course, there is still a lot of uncertainty as to how this is going to pan out in the coming days. Even the science, nobody is sure, because uncertainty exists even with regard to as to what kind of cure that is going to come, right? Though the scientists and the people in the field of medicine are trying hard. So therefore, the economic and other kind of crisis that has been unfolding, right? How far that would go and how deep it would be also would depend on how COVID disease or pandemic is going to be addressed in terms of medical intervention. And at the same time, as I said, that this is an unprecedented kind of a pandemic. It has touched all aspects. So while the scientists are trying to understand the genealogy and so many other things and trying to find a medicine, so it is necessary that people in other fields also must reflect, right? From epidemiology to even sociology and social scientists, economists, because all are in some way or the other reflecting, definitely must look into it and come up with some clear understanding and clarity, so that in this unprecedented crisis, we are in a position to tackle the disease as well as its impact in a much better way. So being a student of rural areas, right, rural development, rural livelihoods, so I was keen that I should look at what is happening in rural areas because of the COVID. How much of population has been affected? Why rural has been affected in this scenario? And what impact COVID has caused in rural areas? These are some of the specific questions that I am going to address in this seminar. And of course, though personally, as I said, that I'm a student of rural development, but looking at rural dimensions of COVID is important, because rural, of course, is a major segment in India. I'm going to share some data. And rural areas and rural population faces many disadvantages vis-a-vis the urban. Even when it comes to health sector, rural has several disadvantages. In fact, the incidence of many diseases are much higher in rural areas. In fact, TB, which is also a much bigger kind of a disease or an epidemic in India, right? So more than, in fact, 2.6 million get affected by TB. And more than 4 lakh die every year, of course, which is much bigger than what we have seen in terms of COVID. And there are also rural-urban differences in TB. Rural is having much higher incidence of TB than urban. So therefore, rural, even when it comes to diseases, display certain kinds of behavior or response. And it would be interesting also, therefore, to understand from the point of view of COVID as to what is the scenario in rural. So therefore, those are the kinds of interests I have, questions that I have got, and I'm going to address them. Because how do I want to look at this entire scenario, the impact of COVID in rural areas? Of course, being a social scientist, my interest is mainly to look at as to how various groups are being affected because of the COVID, right? So I want to adopt some kind of a political economy framework wherein the interests of different groups needs to be looked at even as COVID sort of plays out, and what balancing role possibly the state may play. so that the crisis, the impact of crisis is not felt or by any particular segment. So there is some kind of balancing role state could play, like all even in the past, and even in Great Depression or any such crisis, state has been advocated to play a major role, and here also it is expected. So what kind of balancing role it might play? So therefore, mine is a kind of a political economy framework, and under that I would try and analyze what I want to sort of, you know, proposed here. And how I'm going to do this? Suppose I'm fully relying on the official data. So there are a lot of arguments about the data. So one need to also clearly say the limitations. I must at the outset say a lot of limitations. The data is tentative. A lot of inconsistency is there. Even some have raised a lot of suspicion over data of some of the states and some of the governments. So therefore, given that I'm attempting this, and incidentally, there is no data per se on rural. There are certain kinds of data that exist, so I'm using them to info for rural areas. So that is the sort of basic limitation that is there. But for the impact, what I have done is that I as part of my sabbatical, I did a resurvey of two villages. So I am going to use the data from these two villages, so particularly on the impact of migration as to why this happened, this phenomenon happened, and what kind of impact it will have. So the primary survey data also will be made use of, and I have been also having discussion with households in these villages and also with some NGOs. So all those qualitative and quantitative insights I am going to use. So with those caveats, so I start making my presentation on my findings. Of course, this is the rural scenario, right? So the urban-rural kind of a space, demographic space that exists in terms of the population, population ratio, number of villages and towns, and also the density. Of course, we may also take note of the density. Urban density is much higher than in rural areas, right? So 279 in rural areas versus 3,685 in urban areas. In fact, about TV, it is told that though the general prevalence is much higher in rural areas, but the kind of infection that happens, so is much higher in urban areas. One person in urban area, because of the density, spreads TB much faster in urban than in rural. So therefore, these demographic factors also become important in understanding the incidence and the spread. But it's also a kind of a general idea. When I'm saying rural, I also mean this space, this rural demographic and geographic space. Though, of course, rural is needs to be segregated in terms of various social groups, etc., to understand well. But at a macro level, this is what we see. Yeah, so this is the incidence of COVID as of today. Of course, globally and also in India, the cases are going up. In India also, of course, people say that the lockdown possibly has helped slow the rate of spread. But in the last few days, we are seeing it is growing very fast. There are predictions that we are yet to reach the peak, and possibly in a couple of months, by June or July, India might be reaching peak. So those are all the kinds of, assessments by various experts, which all have to be taken with a pinch of salt, because we don't know exactly how it may pan out in the coming days. But irrespective of the fact that, yes, the outreach of COVID in India also is now fairly significant. Indian the cases have now almost come close to what China had reached in terms of its peak, right? 78,000 is almost similar to the figure China reached during the peak of COVID. So India had reached that stage. And possibly, so this may go even further. Yeah, so coming specifically to the issue of COVID in rural areas. Of course, this is a novel disease. It has, in some sense, is new in many ways, and it's also a global pandemic. It has spread all over, but people are still also trying to analyze this. Some are calling it this as a kind of a disease of the north, or maybe disease. Initially, people were telling this is a disease of the temperate zone. So, like that, various ways people were trying to characterize the pandemic. And even now there are such attempts, right, to characterize this phenomenon. But and then of course there are also a lot of data in terms of the male-female ratio and other aspects. But so far, no clear idea even from China as to what is the rural incidence and what is the kind of spread. Though, of course, rural also has been affected severely because of the lockdown, the economic crunch crisis that has unfolded, right? So I had attempted this for China initially. And then, of course, China's picture showed me that there is some kind of a skewed prevalence of COVID. The Hubei province alone accounted for nearly 83% of all the cases in China. And in terms of the rural spread, I could not get. All that I could get was, after a lot of research, was that so the farmer and labor segment accounted for 21% of the cases. So one may take that as an indicator of the rural, right? So if that is the case, yeah, so rural was also affected, farmers were also affected, though to a lesser extent, but the exact proportion is not known. I looked at even the official sources, etc. So overall, rural reach of COVID in China was lower, and there was in general a kind of a skewed distribution of COVID spread in China. Of course, the various kinds of interventions, including the lockdown and also the behavior of rural community themselves, affected this, right? Though economy got affected equally well. So for my assessment of COVID for rural India is that broadly, the same pattern is going to play out in India if some of those features are going to be replicated. So I would, as of now, based on whatever has happened, because of course it is still unfolding, as some people say, the peak is yet to come. As of now, I would characterize the COVID in India as urban in spread, yet more universal in impact, right? Particularly the economic impact, right? But of course, as to what is going to happen in future, we need to see. But even if it is mainly urban in reach, but how much of rural has been reached by COVID, right? So again, I try to look at the data from various state governments. The state governments are releasing the data. So except for some indirect kind of hint, there is no clear idea as to what is the rural spread. Some states are giving some if not rural, urban, but by municipalities they are giving. I've used that kind of an indirect data to infer about rural. So given the aggregate and the urban data that is there, I have tried to do some kind of a deconstruction, right? Deconstruction from the aggregate urban to arrive at the rural. And that has given me some idea as to what is the kind of incidence or what is the kind of magnitude in rural areas. So as I said, that how I have done, so again, I have done in an indirect way, right? So if you look at the five major states which account for over 70% of the cases, right? Maharashtra, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Delhi, and Rajasthan, right? 70% of the cases and 70 deaths and 72% of the cases, right? Incidentally, they are also urban in nature. So they have a higher urban ratio, except Rajasthan, which possibly is telling that COVID is also showing similar kind of a trend in India also. It is skewed and also tending to be urban. So, and there is data for top cities, right? All cities rather, top cities in terms of the COVID spread account for 53% of the total cases so far. Of course, the data is 2 or 3 days old. I have been analyzing. It's not latest. That is not for today, but it is for last 2 or 3 days. Yeah, so the top cities themselves account for 53% of the total cases. The rest of India, including rural, possibly maybe accounting for the rest. Of course, what is then is the rural share in the rest, if we exclude these five major cities. So again, I try to look at the data at the state level and district level. District level data is in very it's not very consistent. So what I did again, at least for two states, I attempted where the data is little more clear. One for Maharashtra. Maharashtra is releasing data by all municipal corporations, all major cities and municipal corporations. So I aggregated the data for municipal corporations and the municipal and major cities, so which comes to about 94%. So therefore, the smaller towns and villages possibly are accounting for 6% of the total COVID spread in Maharashtra. Similar kind of a picture exists for Karnataka. I try to look at the division by major cities, and similar way, so the urban areas account for over 92% of the cases in Karnataka, right? So therefore, the if you take Karnataka and Maharashtra, where only data is available, I don't know about other states, but these two states, Maharashtra of course is a major state accounting for over 1/3 of the COVID cases. If you take this as possibly as an indicator, rural spread could be about 6 to 8%. But of course, in other states, it's much lower. So therefore, the overall COVID spread in rural, as far as my assessment is concerned, could be less than, of course, I don't want to make any guess because it is still evolving, but at this stage is not more than 5%, right? If you want to take the overall urban picture, compile all the data, etc., right? So therefore, the picture that I had presented for China is also getting, in some way, getting reflected. So why, though it is called global pandemic, it should have reached all regions, all pockets, but why this skewed spread? That's because, of course, since COVID does not have, like TB has a very uniform spread in India, right? Though, of course, rural-urban disparity is there. This is, of course, a new kind of a pandemic. There is no medicine. So only preventive measures help. So the way it is spreading from global to national to regional, and then ultimate to maybe to towns and villages, it's a long chain. So the rural and the rural community are at the end of this global chain and this global pandemic. So Indian rural segment, rural areas physically are at a distance from the global, our own urban centers and also the global area, global hotspots. So therefore the spread of COVID in India in rural areas has been slow. Maybe in the coming days it might happen. And that chain also further has been broken by the lockdown that has been imposed, right? So the lockdown that we have been following is applicable even to rural areas. So all the rural urban movements have been restricted, though agriculture and other activities to an extent there is relaxation, but the movement of people between rural to urban or urban to rural has been restricted by the lockdown. And as a result, so the spread of COVID in that sense has been hampered. It is therefore now largely confined to urban areas, right? Of course, at the same time, the villagers also themselves have been following, villagers themselves have adopted the various kinds of measures, including they are following their own kind of lockdown, and many villages are not allowing any external people to come to their place. So there is some kind of a internal lockdown also. So, and that has prevented the spread in rural areas. But of course, with the relaxation coming in and also with migrants going back, possibly things might turn different, right? And so we have to see this as to how in the second wave, third wave that is going to come, how this would pan out, whether it would remain as urban centric or even rural will come under the impact of COVID. But irrespective of the incidents, right, the impact on social and economic life is being felt in both the rural and urban areas. So therefore, from the incidents, which is more of an academic exercise so far, I turn to the impact side, right? Impact, of course, is being seen on at least broadly on the health segment, the livelihoods, and also on the social life, right? Social life all over has been affected, like we also are facing that, right, if not our livelihoods. And globally, it is being predicted that there will be a, probably a major kind of a recession, right, if not a depression. And there will be a significant decline in output, employment, and income. Even for India, it is being visualized, though IMF says that India and China might do little better than other countries in the coming days because of the way the COVID has played out, and also the kind of possibly the measures that are being taken. Yeah, but though the as I said that the incidence is lower, but the economic and social impact is going to be much higher. Like, of course, we have a saying, local saying, right? When bullock gets fever, buffalo gets branded. Though urban has got the fever, so the rural also will feel the pinch, right? So something like that. Yeah, so what is the pinch? The pinch possibly will be on three areas. One is in the one on the agriculture and elite sectors. And then the second is the non-farm areas, non-farm activities in rural areas. And of course, only the third is the rural to urban migration, right? So these are the three areas where I'm trying to sort of figure out as to what has happened. For that, I have gone back to my village studies. So I'm doing, as I said, that intertemporal study. I have recently conducted a repeat survey after 25 years in these two villages of Gujarat, one in Surendranagar district, another in Dahod. These are largely in the semi-arid areas where there is a lot of migration. Huge amount of migration takes place. They are not green revolution areas. So, and of course, and the insights from these two villages tell me as to the kind of, you know, outpouring that we saw of the migrants on the roads and all the kind of distress that they were facing. What is the reason? So therefore, I want to share some of the insights from these two villages. So one, of course, is a tribal area. Of course, tribals also migrate very significantly. Another is a multi-caste village, Budaya. So the pictures are different. I'll quickly sort of go through the kind of, you know, insights that I have got. Of course, this is still a tentative data. I'm still analyzing. So as I said that these are semi-arid areas. So though irrigation in Bodia, one village is a little higher than in the tribal areas. So the literacy is much lower. And then, of course, the household size is one thing that we must see here. There's significant household size. So my data comparison between the past findings is telling that there is significant increase in population. So I need to anyway look back, look into this again. But that's what my initial kind of, you know, analysis have shown. So there is increased labor force, surplus labor, and then division and subdivision of land is happening in a very significant way. Yeah. So what is the livelihoods of these people? So as can be seen, of course, tribals and also even in the other land is an important resource. So agriculture is an important activity. Besides that, they also pursue animal husbandry, agriculture labor, and non-farm activities, right? But migration is an important activity. So in the tribal village, nearly 87% of the households migrate, whereas in the other multi-caste village, nearly 45% migrate. And even female migrates in significant number of households, right? And the average number of migrants in tribal area, it is almost 3 per household. Though in the multi-caste village, it is about 1.1. right? And there is migration for significant number of days. The per capita migration days, as can be seen, is fairly significant, very high. And the earnings from migration, of course, I will show some of the distribution by region of this migration, etc. So is relatively fairly significant in tribal areas. Given that their agricultural incomes are lower, the earnings from migration accounts for 68% of their total earnings. And in the other multi-caste village, migration accounts for about 38% of the total income, right? Because there the landholding is much higher, agricultural income is much higher. It is 2.18 lakh per household in Bodia, whereas it is merely 24,000 rupees in the tribal village. So the agricultural incomes in tribal areas are much lower than in other villages, and migration therefore is an important strategy, and migration income constitute a significant proportion of the household income. And as I said, that by nature even female migrate to a significant extent. Yeah, so given this that there is dependence on agriculture and also non-farm activities, and more so on migration, right? So what is the kind of scenario that I visualize? What has happened in the last year, 1920, that is the year that we have just passed, in which, of course, the COVID impact also has been felt. So in these two villages, of course, agriculture, not much of impact has happened. Agricultural activities have taken place. Even in the Rabi, though there were some difficulties in terms of harvest, but the farmers managed to harvest. But incomes are lower because prices, they have not been able to recover. That is one kind of a scenario that I'm visualizing. This is also based on my discussions with the farmers. Local non-farm activities, because of the lockdown, there has been a curtailment. So therefore, both the activity level as well as the income from local non-farm activities are also much lower for the year 2019 and 2020. But one area where there is much severe impact is migration, because the COVID impact has happened mainly, the lockdown and all those kinds of barriers came mainly during summer. And much of the migration, particularly in tribal areas, is during summer. It's a seasonal kind of migration, and most of them migrate during summer. So literally, their summer migration, which is the major migration season, has been affected. Though, of course, still a lot of people go there. But even if they would have been there in urban areas, but they were unable to earn their incomes, right? Because there was no work, literally construction, various activities had come to a standstill. So therefore, I visualize that for 2019 and 20, their income from migration would be very severely affected. For the coming year, my visualization is that agriculture possibly would continue. Farmers would manage to cultivate and would be able to come up with the output, unless that's a kind of a drought year or any such kind of a crisis, outputs would, if at all there is any decline due to any kind of break in the supply chain of inputs and other such resources, output would be only marginally, possibly might decline because of that. Incomes will be lower because I visualize, because of the again problem in the supply chain, the prices would be lower in the coming year. Local non-farm activities also would go on in a lower level because the demands would be lower. And if the situation continues in the same way, the migration in the coming years would be lower for two reasons, because the activities will take considerable time to pick up. But at the same time, in the coming year, many of them possibly, I'm just guessing, many of them may not migrate. They may stay back. The aged and children and female, etc., may not migrate. So the extent of migration, even if normalcy is restored, is going to be much lower. So this is the kind of scenario that I am predicting for these two villages. Possibly in all other villages having similar kind of background at All India level would play out, because migration, particularly of this distressed nature, has a similar kind of a background. And when I said that it's going to be severely affected, these are the kind of activities migrants are involved in. right? Variety of activities that I have identified. Whereas in the tribal areas, construction is one major activity. 82% of the households, our labor force is involved in construction activity from tribal area, tribal village that I have studied. In the other, it is other kinds of activities, some semi-skilled, etc. Though largely, for both the villages, it's private casual type of employment, which accounts for 96% of the employment for tribal and about 64% of the employment for the multi-caste village. Of course, there is a difference between tribal and multi-caste villages in terms of this migration pattern. So during construction, during lockdown, literally all these activities came to a halt. Only a very limited kind of activities took place. Maybe some trade and business in rural areas, some agricultural activity, but construction and various other kinds of activities, technical activities, factory work, etc. So they, even diamond work, they all almost came to a standstill, and hence migration, employment and income, as per me, has suffered and it will be suffering. And of course, we are seeing that these people are all trying to move out. In all these cities, we are seeing even protests, at least in Gujarat, for the migrants, which are the towns, right? As we can see, so they go to various towns like Ahmedabad, Surat, and even local towns, right? It is spread all across Gujarat. So all towns get these migrants, right? This flow of migrants that we are seeing, right? Of course, the estimation was that close to the working group on migrants had estimated nearly 60 million migrants, people who migrate for work, right? 60 million migrants in India. So they go to various kinds of towns, right? And in Gujarat, so these are the kinds of destination, and they went for their summer migration, summer work, but the towns got locked down, they all got stuck, no employment, no income, though there was some kind of a relief, etc. being given. They were under duress, desperation was there, therefore they wanted to go back to their villages, right, from all these towns. So why this scenario is because these towns, which are the source of employment, got locked down. And second important reason, if you again look at the, as to where do these migrants stay, which I tried to capture in my study, tribals almost stay in open place, khulla mein rehte hain, they say. And if there is employment, that is fine. And if there is lockdown and no employment, no wages, they can't even live also in the open. They have to go back. That is why they were literally suffering in many of these towns and cities, and they were desperate to go back, which possibly the authorities were not able to understand. And even other multi-caste village where people work in some kind of industry, etc., they take houses on rent, but there also there were difficulty. They had to pay rent, like here in Bodia, 68% migrate, and the migrants take houses on rent, but with no earnings, they were not able to pay rent, and they were also desperate to go back. Like for example, all the diamond workers were keen to go back to their villages, but were unable to. Recently, even they were also on the road protesting, send us back to Saurashtra and our villages, like that. So this is another reason as to why this outpourings of migrants labor we are seeing, right? And of course, the next aspect, the government has tried to give various relief packages. What is the potential outreach of these relief packages? Yesterday also there was an announcement. Based on my data, for all the schemes that government has announced under the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, right, for relief under this package, I had tried to estimate what could be the possible outreach. But actual working is very, very bad. PDS at the most will reach in tribal village 51%. But in that village, the PDS shops are not working okay. They're having difficulties. MG Narega, which is important in these periods, in these villages, literally MG Narega work was not there. But other schemes like, of course, direct benefit transfer schemes like PMJDY or the Pradhan Mantri Kisan, they have a slightly higher outreach. Maybe they would work, but other schemes will have difficulty. So therefore, there are also arguments that maybe direct schemes, transfer schemes also could be tried out. So MG Narega, of course, in Gujarat, it is not implemented very well. Today also I was listening to the finance minister, but she did not make any allocation, any increase in the allocation, though she says that we have increased the wages. Without higher allocation for MG Narega work cannot be increased. Government probably must do that. So all other kind of schemes, I have tried to work out the possible outreach. So even 3 months loan moratorium, if rural households want, about 42% of them possibly can claim. MSME loan package announced yesterday, micro industries in rural areas, about 13% in Mahudi village and 18% possibly can get the benefit, provided they work. This is only the outreach I am saying. Right, maximum possible outreach. It is not universal. There are variations across scheme. So therefore, the government the need for universalization, at least in terms of PDS, public distribution system, and food, that needs to be taken care of if there is going to be continued lockdown and continued unemployment situation. Yeah, so this is the kind of potential thing that I have estimated. So last, I would conclude based on my analysis and findings. Yeah, so COVID so far is an urban phenomenon, though other impacts are being felt even in other areas. It's urban in spread, and more universal in impact. So I have sort of made an assessment so far, but there is no rural data. We must gather officially. There is no attempt being made to make this classification. I don't know whether they have it even in their application, etc. But in the coming days, at least they should streamline the rural data to have much clearer idea. But rural livelihoods and the migration, etc., have suffered. And given the income and employment that we saw, dependence on migration, poverty is likely to increase. Agricultural incomes are also going to reduce because the prices may not be realized to the extent that used to be realized. And the schemes, there is a mixed outreach. But if they have to make a better impact, they need to be streamlined. All the bottlenecks that are there, even in PDS, there are severe bottlenecks. So unless they are removed, there will be severe constraint, right? Yeah, agriculture possibly would not suffer, at least agricultural output per se, though there could be certain bottlenecks. So unless it's going to be a drought or such crisis, we can expect agricultural activities to thrive even in the coming year, and government therefore must do all possible, give all possible support to agriculture and allied activities. Because today also they were announcing, but I would say give interest-free loans, higher allocation for MG Narega, and link it to also agriculture, and enable good agri supply chains. Because in summer there were a lot of constraints to get inputs, which I could guess from my interactions, right? But COVID may also spread in rural areas, so therefore even agricultural activity, local activities may also get affected. But they must be continued with due safeguards. Right, of course, at least food production, agricultural production must be ensured. So therefore, our lockdown norms should be agriculture specific, enabling agriculture and allied activities, right? So, and of course, we need to work out more rural specific measures, because as I said, rural plays out differently. And of course, overall, of course, as I said, that even poverty possibly might go up because the incomes and employments have suffered. In terms of demography, if migration is going to suffer, there is possibly going to be reversal of rural to urban migration. And in my view, 2021 census possibly might show slightly a different picture, though rural was declining. And means it is growing at only 12%, much lower than the urban. That might reduce, right? So means that might reverse. So there could be increase in rural population, rural share from 68%. Whether it would go down, possibly it might stabilize or it might even marginally go up if migration is going to be affected. Rural to urban migration is going to be affected severely. Yeah, so these are some of my thoughts on COVID and rural area. So I thank all of you for your patience. In case there are any queries, comments, I would welcome them, particularly your own insights. So thank you all.
Professor Shailendra, thank you for this wonderful talk. We have three questions as of now, and if there are any more questions, we invite you to the comment section.
Yeah.
Professor Indraneel Day has asked, would the occupation of migrants have implications on impact? Tribal village has better cover with respect to the government support system. Where will the impact be higher?
Yeah, the migration impact, of course, as I said, that how much they have suffered because of the urban lockdown. Migration income is from the, what I showed was rural to urban migration. It's all from various towns and cities. So how much of that employment has suffered will affect the extent of income loss that they have suffered, right? And in terms of the schemes, of course, since it's a kind of the economic, the crisis has been felt by all have suffered economically, even farmers have suffered. So therefore, because the output they have been able to realize, but they have suffered in terms of value addition and also in terms of realizing better prices. So therefore, the relief packages have to be addressed to all sections. So that is how I would see. I hope I understood your question and I have answered it.
So my question, basically I'm just trying to understand that, see, these two villages have two different patterns.
Yeah.
So the multi-caste one is a little more, they are, in different occupations, in the migrant ones, right? Whereas single caste one is they are mainly concentrating on a particular kind of occupation, that is construction, right?
Yeah.
I mean talking about the migrants, right?
Yeah.
Now, since my argument is that what do you think, that if those people were there are multicaste people and they are into different kind of occupations, right, as a migrant, so would their impact of this lockdown and all sort of things, economic slowdown, would it impact them less? So that is one. And second, so in that or maybe that since they are dealing with the goods and commodities which are luxurious in nature, for example diamond, so maybe that they might be get impacted more. So that's one trying to understand. But the second thing is that one is the impact from the occupation. The other thing is that the coverage they get, right? So the government, so this government coverage means I'm talking about different existing coverage, right? Now in the existing coverage, what I find, the overall, the tribal villages are better covered in terms of government coverage, right?
Yeah.
Support system. Existing support system. So, I mean, overall, if you are asked to assess where the impact would be higher, given that migration would, from migration point of view, there will be some impact. And the second thing is that government support system is going to cover up that impact to some extent. So, on the balance, where do you think, in your assessment, the impact would be higher?
Yeah. So, of course, these two villages are also different in terms of their dependence on migration, and also there are variations across different sections, right? Of course, the landed for them, as I said, that the agricultural income is much better. So they have realized a food, agricultural output, and though lower prices, their incomes are much better, right? So the major share of their annual income they have realized, the landed group. Whereas the laboring community, which depends, of course, also on agricultural labor and also the migration, right? So they are the ones who have suffered. And particularly, as I said, that this lockdown came during summer, and much of this migration happens during summer. So therefore, the laboring class and those who depend on migration to a significant extent, they are going to be affected. For them, the migration income accounts for 68% of their total income. So therefore, and much of the migration, rather almost entire migration of this segment is to various towns and cities. So literally, they would have lost nearly 60% or more of their income, right? So, and therefore, if the government also wants to compensate by various relief, right? So, therefore, this laboring class, the migrant laborers, right? So, they would need much, much better support, right? Otherwise, if no employment is going to come up, even MG Narega is not going to be there, the situation would be very bad, right? So, therefore, the free food supply scheme that the government has announced, additional 5 kg, etc., that probably may need to be supported, right? Of course, government is not giving PDS, this free rice, 5 kg rice or wheat, to the APL group. It is giving only to the BPL. So such kind of differences need to be made, because economically it is this group which has suffered, and their existence is a hand-to-mouth existence on a daily basis. So, and if there is a longer lockdown, they will have really terrible time. So therefore, that outreach in tribal areas was significant, because there are more BPL people than in other villages, right? So therefore, that broadly is fine. But now, possibly, some of these schemes can be even universalized also, as is being argued. Those who need food must be definitely given without exception. This APL-BPL distinction possibly might be relaxed, given the good food stock that we have got.
Sir, Ms. Lalita Narayanan has asked, were the farmers able to access the market with their harvest?
Yes, I was trying to understand this from the farmers of these two villages, right? In the tribal village, they grow mainly maize during Kharif and wheat during Rabi. And in tribal areas, they're except those who may have some irrigation, who grow some vegetables and such crops, much of their production is for their self-consumption, right? So therefore, the issue of accessing market, except for those who grow vegetables, right? So that was allowed. That was allowed to an extent they were able to realize. But so in tribal areas, in general, they did not face much of marketing fraud. But in the other village, so they grow cotton and also wheat, jeera, and other kinds of crops, right? Incidentally, of course, cotton harvesting had already taken place for, I'm talking of 2019 and 20. So they had already realized prices for cotton, though of course still sales are also going on, because many farmers hold on till they get good prices, etc. But much of it has already been done. And about the rabi crop, wheat and jowar are the two major crops. I'm talking from the villages I have studied. Again, their wheat is for mainly for their self-consumption. To a great extent, they retain. And there were, of course, hurdles for wheat sales. Many of them, they said that they would hold it back, right? So wheat can be stored. So there was no problem majorly, though wheat again there in this non-tribal village is also used for their domestic consumption, right? Yeah, so therefore the major problem has happened in the case of horticultural crops all over India. Major problem has happened in the case of horticultural crops, except those which are for local markets. But many farmers grow horticultural crops, whether it may be onion, tomato, etc. So they grow for far-off markets. With lockdown and with no transportation, supply side totally having broken, these horticultural and such crops, which are basically for far-off markets, those farmers have suffered. Like, for example, even in Gujarat, only Rajkot APMC was working till recently. Farmers from Maharashtra were coming, because many of their markets were not working. But even they closed for onion and such crops, and they have suffered. So that is how possibly it has worked out. It is a differentiated kind of an impact. Agriculturally, farmers who have grown food crops have not faced many problems. But other crops, commercial crops for outside market, global market, floriculture, etc., they have suffered severely. So therefore, in the coming next year, farmers would be largely going for food crops instead of commercial crops. Mostly, they may give up horticultural crops. They were not able to grow that this year. They may give up. Many of them would give up. So unless there is some kind of a support buyback arrangement or some other kind of interventions, horticultural crops in the coming years would suffer and their prices might go up. So that is what has happened. But we all know what happened to chicken, poultry industry much before even the lockdown, because of all the kinds of false news, etc. Yeah, so that is my assessment as far as marketing of agricultural crops based on these two villages.
Okay, sir, thank you. Mr. Rishabh Pandey asks, sir, how will the removal of restrictions on farmers for selling their produce out of mandis and directly to the bulk buyers affect them? How will the removal of restrictions on farmers for selling their produce out of the mandis and directly to the bulk buyers affect them?
Yeah, but of course, even if the bulk buyers wants to go on directly reach out to farmers, in the lockdown, even that was not possible, right? So a lot of people, for example, I know one tomato mandi in Karnataka. So a lot of people in South Karnataka, I have visited that market, they come from Kerala and other pockets to buy tomato from there and directly from the farmers, There is a unique tomato market, but they were not able to come, right? So of course, if the bulk buyers were able to access and farmers were able to reach, and if that could be worked out even in the coming years, that would work well, right? Possibly farmers may realize better prices. But at the same time, we need to, at least for agricultural products, this APMC working needs to be streamlined, proper safeguards needs to be kept. Maybe even technology can be used so that social distancing and such measures are followed. Otherwise, of course, these bulk buyers, maybe people like certain markets, certain kind of, what are these retail malls, etc., they may be buying, but that is only a limited kind of a purchase. Ultimately, farmers depend on APMC and such major institutional markets, right? And they need to be streamlined, technology and various norms, but there have been a lot of violations this time in terms of marketing, etc. So though they allowed them, agricultural activities were allowed, but based on the lessons, these institutional agencies like APMC also needs to be streamlined. Bulk traders also can come there. They can also do that. Such restrictions possibly now with the liberalized thing, we may not be able to put. Working has to be ensured. Supply chain has to be ensured. That links have to be ensured. Literally, they had broken down, and as a result, As I said, these commercial crops, farmers, those who have grown commercial crop, particularly in the last summer, Rabi and summer, they have suffered. So that should be the attention of government, and only then possibly farmers would be able to benefit. Both kind of arrangements, institutional arrangements, needs to be put in place.
Yes, sir, thank you. Mr. Suraj Gohil asks, the main crop of villages also plays an important role, such as if the main crop is wheat, they can store it, the villages can store it and get price after lockdown. But if it is a perishable product like fruits, like pomegranate or mango, which cannot be stored for too long, it has to be sold locally, and this creates supply chain cut and lower prices for the farmers. What are your views on this?
No, our procurement, though governments promise that they every time there is some kind of a glut, they say that we will procure onion, we will procure potato, we will procure tomato, etc. State governments do these promises. But they do only some token kind of purchases. They never buy substantially. When there is a glut, farmers suffer, right? So now It was a kind of a glut that got created because of the scarcity of demand and problem in the supply chain, right? So as I said, that possibly next year we can see for many farmers will be switching over to non-horticultural crops, maybe mainly food crops and such crops which possibly can be stored or which can be sold locally, right? So that is what possibly would be the cropping pattern in the next year. So unless therefore the supply chains are going to be sort of opened up with due safeguards, and that and there is some kind of an assurance, so horticultural crops are going to suffer, and their prices also possibly might go up. Horticulture crops prices, my tomato, onion, grapes or whatever, so their prices also might go up. That is what I visualize. So therefore the Ministry of Agriculture and the state governments must work a kind of a plan from now itself for the next year. Otherwise, so those farmers who have suffered will again, if they by chance go for same crops, because many of them would have already made investment, for example grapes, etc. So they're all sort of in some way long term, right? They've already made investments. So unless these supply chains are arranged and marketing avenues are linked up, those farmers will not going to make any investments, even if the government is saying that we are going to give them loan, etc., at subsidized rates. So if they are not going to get sort of assured market, some minimum prices, etc., they will not even avail these loans. They may avail these loans for their consumption purpose, if not for production and investment purpose.
Okay, so thank you. Miss Monica Vanga asks, sir, MNREGA has definitely increased the income of rural households, but can we say that it is a sustainable income? From our village fieldwork segment experience, I noticed that the living conditions of rural households have improved, but the dependency on this program has increased. How can the government ensure that the next step is to generate other sources of income in times of COVID?
Yeah, so MNREGA, of course, see, government has in general put a limit of 100 days per household. Government has put a cap of 100 days in working of MNREGA in the normal times, right? So if you look at the migration days for a tribal village, per capita migration days, work days is 119. And for non-tribal, the per capita migration days is 229 days. The average employment generated at All India level by MNREGA is hardly 45 days. Even last year, it was 48 days. So I don't say, and added to that, there is no certainty in the work of NREGA. It is not being organized everywhere. Farmers have given up hopes in many places, like in Gujarat. They just don't depend on MNREGA. So panchayats are using it for various other kinds of works, right? So now is the time for that scheme to work. If urban employment is not going to be there for these migrants, right? As I said, that 119 days of per capita employment in tribal area means totally for a family, it is more than 350 days of employment. They are going to lose, that family is going to lose this employment. At least 100 days of MNREGA government should ensure. They have not allocated, they said that we have increased 20 rupees of wage, they have increased, but they have not made any increased allocation. So therefore now there will be more enrollment of MNREGA, older people, women, etc. will all stay back, they will all demand MNREGA, and it is necessary in this kind of a crisis period, like in the Keynesian thing. Dig well, close well, right? A dig pit or a close pit. That is the kind of a mantra during the depression to revive the economy and to help people sustain. So if along with that, if you don't do that, then they will try and depend only on, even if MNREGA is not organized, then they will depend on only free supply of ration. At least MNREGA, there will be some work. Because if lockdown can somehow be eased and COVID will in some way get restrained, and if those non-farm employment in urban areas are going to get restored, they will not depend on MNREGA. Many automatically they migrate, they just don't look for MNREGA, right? So, but in this crisis period, it is necessary, it must be calibrated well to suit the existing needs.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Sir, just one announcement. We have 4 to 5 more questions. We'll complete them. We won't be accommodating any more questions. So I'll carry on with the questions that we already have. Professor Preeti Priya says, thanks for an insightful presentation on COVID outbreak from the perspective of rural development. You are also an expert in the field of rural finance. How do you see the rural household financial behavior undergoing a change as a consequence of the COVID outbreak? And also the economic package announced for the rural populace.
Yes, thank you, Preeti. In fact, somebody was suggesting that I should give a webinar on rural and microfinance like that. Though I was more keen on giving a task on webinar on this. Yeah. So just to quickly reflect. So the debt, of course, is an issue. Even during normal times, right? How people would in microfinance and rural segments, bankers are reluctant to do because they assume that much of this will go to consumption, right? Even now, government has announced a package, and it says that SMEs can be given loans up to 20 lakhs. Bankers were reluctant to give loans even up to 20 lakhs. I'm not sure therefore how far the bankers will volunteer to give this loan sanctioned up to 20 lakhs for the SHGs. Even in normal times, they were reluctant to give 5 lakhs. Right? So even for the farmers, with the subvention, the maximum loan that farmers used to get, agricultural crop loan farmer used to get was only 3 lakhs. And some interest subvention was playing a role in that, and government has extended interest subvention now up to June end. Just before I came for this seminar, I was listening to the finance minister, right? So those constraints are going to be still there. So though the government has announced a package, but it will remain much of this kind of activities would remain on paper. But even if they are going to be distributed, they probably there could be a lot of favoritism and such things might happen, because there is a possibility that all these loans now being given might be one day written off, and all of them would like to avail these micro and agricultural loans. I made an estimation also how many of them can avail this in these villages. At least my assessment showed that good number of people possibly can MSM get at least 13% in tribal village, 18% in Bodia, MSMI loans, right? And I was listening to a webinar on MFIs. In fact, many MFI customers wanted to repay. They did not want to use this three months moratorium that has been given, right? Because at least those who had not been affected, right? But later on, they decided to hold back this 3 months moratorium, right? Yeah, so this is I think these are some of the key insights I found about rural finance during this COVID period.
Right. Okay, thank you, sir. I'll carry forward the discussion with you.
Okay, thank you. Yes, good. Yeah. Shivansh, can we wind up? Because I see Sahid on the screen. He has been there on my screen continuously. How are you, Sahid? Doing fine. Okay, good. That's good. You're at home? Okay. Right. Any other? I don't know if there are any other questions.
I think Shivansh.
Am I audible now? My apologies.
Yeah.
Okay. So, sir, the next question is from Mr. Praveen Kuntoji. He asked, as migrants and other people have started losing their livelihoods, do you think the government of India should adopt basic income scheme to sustain these people and their livelihoods? If yes, would it be really possible for the government to adopt such a scheme even when the government is suffering from revenue losses?
Yeah, there are of course a lot of arguments, and many are advocating even globally. There are arguments for adopting even for the developed countries such a basic income scheme. So if those arguments have in that sense validity, there also possibly they might have certain validity even here also. We are state governments and including the central government, we have already adopted some kind of already basic income schemes, right? At least two income schemes. Now government is transferring this 500 rupees to every Jandan account, right, to the women, all women. Government is already transferring 6,000 rupees to every farmer. Government is transferring 1,000 rupees to this old age and other people. So we have adopted, at least in some skeletal form, these basic income scheme. So it is now, if, as I said, that yes, if possibly, if the impact of COVID is going to be much higher, that would also justify adopting such a scheme. If government, otherwise government, if is not going to generate jobs, government itself is not able to generate jobs. We all know that. So at least they were depending on the private sector, and now if the private sector jobs also sort of dry up, right, and many of them could be left high and dry, what will be their income source, right? Therefore, what we are giving for such vulnerable groups like old age or widows or PWD and such people, we may possibly have to extend this to other groups, right, until things gets restored to the normal thing. Yeah, so therefore there is a kind of a justification, and government claims that now they have put in this jam network, right, so under which they can do it. At least the leakage part is much less, though there are various kinds of leakages that do take place after the transfer or much before the transfer, but it is relatively better. Of course the question is how far government can go, right? The earlier estimation was that earlier estimation was some 3.6 lakh was one of the crore was one of the estimation, right? Now under COVID, government says that it is giving a total package of 20 lakh crore, which is about 10% of the total GDP. So government is able to mobilize 10% of GDP for this package. This basic income would have constituted only one smaller proportion of that 20 lakh package, which already includes the kind of items that I mentioned. So therefore, they could possibly consider this even for a much wider segment within what they have done. And maybe now I am sure they would like to relax at least all these FPR, FRBM norms, etc., at least in 1 or 2 years, though the outside raters, etc., might be skeptical. But government would be under compulsion. Possibly in the coming days, they might announce even such a basic income scheme if the situation is going to remain acute in the coming days.
Okay, so thank you. Actually, with respect to Jandhan Yojana itself, Mr. Shahidul Islam has asked, what are your views on the amount of rupees 500 with respect to the Jandhan Yojana?
Yeah.
Money, yeah, that has been dispersed.
Yeah, this is basically it has been given for the women. It has been given for women, but it's just 500 in some sense, some kind of a token amount, because it will be given for 3 months. What government has said that it will give it for 3 months. It's a token amount which can possibly help them meet once very, very small, very contingencies. Medicine and such things. It's not a very substantial kind of allocation, because what I said, given the kind of earnings from outside, migration, etc. So compared to that, this is a small amount, but in these kinds of situation, it might play some role and they might continue this for some more time. But unfortunately, there were also bottlenecks initially in the disbursement of this. Every week there used to be long queues of women standing in front of the bank. I hope they have streamlined this, and possibly they could increase this if things remain same, because it's a token amount. 500 is only a token amount, but at least it is reaching the women. But in this, incidentally, as per RBI's estimation, 26% of these accounts remain dormant. Many of them are dormant. I don't know whether they have transferred this money to dormant accounts. Also, no idea. But as they are now working with this, so they must ensure that these accounts also become workable working accounts, and even other members are also able to get the benefit.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Cynthia Carvalho asks, in this moment of closed borders, family farmers are the answer to local demands for food in many places.
Yeah.
Can this scenario build the basis for the food sovereignty movement like that led by Via Campesina and change the direction of public policies?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, family farms. In a way, of the two villages, in fact, both the villages here, which the data for which I shared, they are basically family farms, right? So they do farming there, right? Though some of them also grow commercial crops. Some of them do commercial crops because they need cash. Both the villages, they try and ensure their own subsistence, wheat, maize, jowar, etc., for their own subsistence, and they grow some commercial crops, cotton and vegetables, etc., for cash income, right? Of course, in the Indian case, almost the entire farming is under family farming, right? And farmers have ensured food production for us, even though now it is a major crisis. So our godowns are flush with 83 million tons of food grains, which will also increase. It is the result of the effort made by our family, farmers who are based on families, right? So that is already there in India, though of course land reforms in general had failed to give access to much larger segment, but farms are in India family oriented with the division. They are now working more and more. They are themselves sort of contributing. Agricultural labor needs are in that sense locally getting reduced. Therefore, agricultural laborers tends to move out, right? This in a sense ensures food production, right? They grow for themselves and also for the market, and they have stakes because their own food security is involved. And therefore, they are ensuring food security for themselves and to the nation as a whole. Yes, I think it's a positive thing, and it's happening. And now, for those who have surplus, with the break in the supply chain, global as well as local, they might suffer. So therefore, these family farms might suffer in terms of their income, and they should be enabled to realize good income and prices apart from their own subsistence.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Ms. Shruti Naraguda asks, sir, what could be the impact of labor law reforms in the coming days?
That is of course I have not touched upon that, but I made one point, one data I showed, that almost 96% of this labor, much of the labor is in the private and casual segment, right? They are in private sector, and many of them work on casual basis, contract or casual basis, right? So already the situation is precarious, right? Very precarious. Now, of course, government, as I said at the beginning, my interest is to look at different interests. Now, of course, the industrialists and the businessmen, they have their own interests. The labor and such groups, they have their own interests. But government thinks that in order to favor the industry and the business, they would like to now relax all these labor laws, at least therefore they are investing and also keep their business going. Otherwise, possibly there could be problem, right? So therefore, there is a lot of pressure on the industry, like what happened also in Bangalore. Construction industry wanted that laborers should not be sent back, they should be retained, right? So those kinds of pressures are already working, and government, in order to please the industry and labor, it was already doing this much before even this crisis came up. Now with the crisis, government is in a way siding with the industry and labor, and hard-earned labor rights are going to be compromised. As I said, I showed the way these migrants, laborers who contribute significantly to urban economy, how they live, what kind of wages they get, right? 83% of the construction laborers live on open spaces, right? There is no onus on the employers to give them decent living, decent wages and decent living. If all these laws are going to be relaxed, this segment is going to suffer severely, right? So therefore, as I said, that there needs to be a balancing act. Even though there is a crisis, government cannot succumb to such pressures from the industry and business. It must play a balancing act and must ensure that the labor rights are also protected.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Before we move on to the last question, I have a comment from Professor Nivedita Kothiyal. Yeah. Thanks, Professor Shailendra, for this excellent talk. I have been following COVID development through media. However, the rural picture is missing. So it was a very informative talk and good to see you and listen to you after such a long time. Best wishes.
Yeah, thank you, Nivedita. Thanks for joining. Thanks for your compliments. Hope you are all doing well.
Sir, last question from Ms. Deepa Gupta.
Yeah.
We are seeing the issues of reverse migration differently. And in coming time, when there will be less migration to cities, what could be the strategy states should follow to provide livelihoods to rural households when PDS and MG Narega may not be able to meet the demand? Do you see the SHG and cooperative model may emerge differently?
Yeah, very good question. Very good question. This, of course, is the whole question, because I'm working on that only, agrarian transformation or rural transformation. How do we sort of, you know, address that issue? That is the kind of research I just drew from that. Maybe I will some other day present my findings of my other major study, if not now, but very quickly. Yeah, rural, yes, of course, the agriculture per se, rural per se, is not able to, in the way it is working, is not able to absorb the entire labor force, right? And at the same time, the needs, rural needs, have also increased, right? Health, education, and various other kinds of expenses, right? There is a considerable increase in the needs of the rural household. So therefore, they look elsewhere. So rural on its own, rural livelihoods, rural activities on their own are not able to sustain. So unless we revive the rural, right, even make agriculture much more productive, much more employment oriented, and such activities, including, of course, organizing them on a cooperative basis, because they get much of the incomes and share in the value chain, right? It's not that easy to revive the rural economy under the current political economy and scenario. That would require an entirely different kind of an approach, because much of it that we have been following is urban oriented, industry oriented kind of investment and policies. As a result, rural activities have suffered. Of course, Amul model has worked, because that is a kind of a very, very proactive, progressive kind of an intervention that was done and made here, based in Anand by agencies like NDDB, with the role played by Dr. Kurian. So we probably need much more such interventions, not only to possibly to increase the participation of farmers, increase employment, etc., but also to increase their control, right? So maybe such activities, along with other kinds of activities like watershed, water harvesting and many such which I've also studied have shown that because of such activities, at least distress migration decreases significantly wherever such interventions have been made. Wherever such interventions are not working, there is desperation and distress, and rural to urban migration goes on. If these interventions are made to work well, distress migration reduces to a significant extent. Yes, so I would therefore, in this kind of a situation, as I said, that rural to urban migration may decline, and we need to support more livelihoods and more interventions in rural areas. And that's why I said that rural population possibly in the coming days might even stabilize. It might not decline in 2021 census if it is going to be conducted, right? And that would require a lot of effort in terms of supporting livelihoods.
Thank you so much, sir. I'd like to close this session now. I thank everyone for joining in.
Thank you so much,
Professor Shailendra, for sharing your insights with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Shivans, for all the help. Because of this, I was able to do this. Thank you very much, Shivans. Thank you all. Take care.